Say hello to Straw People. After almost 20 years, Fiona McDonald and Paul Casserly are scheming again. They've just released their new album, Knucklebones, their first since 2004. Paul and Fiona trekked up to the 13th floor to tell us how Straw People came back together again.
Like a drug invading my blood.
So, you got this new album, Knucklebones, which is the first one in about, what,
19 years?
So the obvious question, and probably the one you've answered several thousand times
why
already.
Why did it take so long?
What were you thinking?
Okay,
why?
Well, I've been thinking about this because we've been answering it the same way. And so I've come up with a new answer. The first answer is we just had other things to do.
Right.
Children, lives,
yep.
Jobs, right? But also I think there's something that happens if you are a creative person mm-hmm. where eventually the bug just comes back and it says, we want to do this again. And we both just got bitten by the bug at the same time.
Oh, that's convenient.
Yeah.
Is that an accurate?
Yes, yeah, and thank you for not mentioning that time I spent in prison. Because that did carve out, that carved out a good seven.
15 years.
A good seven. Seven. Well, good behaviour.
Sure.
There you go.
I did behave well in there. I'll let you know.
In the end, yeah.
But you wrote some good stuff in there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. No, yeah, it was pretty much that. It was, and distracted by other things, so.
Right.
And, you know, other things that kind of, because I worked in TV and make documentaries and stuff like that through that time.
Yep.
And kind of got the same buzz out of collaborating and making stuff that I get. It's a similar but different thing.
Yep.
But there is something more enduring about music, and I did. I often thought when I've got friends who have managed to maintain being a musician all their lives, like Greg Johnson and stuff.
Mm. Yeah.
And I definitely have a certain kind of FOMO and like, oh, if I'd only stuck at it, then could I just kept doing music the whole time. So that was always, you know, one of those things, that list of things that you keep in your head that you beat yourself up with that
yep.
everyone has. There was a bit of that as well. So it was definitely something that I wanted to get back into and just needed a way in, really.
Cool. So who approached whom?
We collided at a dinner party.
Oh, cool.
And he said, "Do you want to?" And I went, "Yep." That was that.
That was that.
Yeah.
Easy as that. So did you have a bunch of songs in the can that
no.
were in,
or no,
was
no.
it all?
We started from scratch.
I mean, I'd been collecting some ideas and some sounds.
Right.
And sometimes I'll just find a sample and think, oh, can I build a track out of this? Doesn't happen very often. There's like, I think the Sleepwalker is the one on there that has a bit of that. Found sounds that then become, you build the song around. Fiona's been writing songs the whole time as well anyway.
Mm.
I often just find, I'll keep a note of something from that I overhear, or a line from literature or
like
journalism,
Second Heart,
or something like that.
That's how that song started, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, well, that's a good place to start. It's the first song on the album. So tell me how that song started.
Baby, you can do what you want.
Second Heart, yeah, that was an idea taken from an Irish novelist whose name I can't remember, but anyway, this notion that the past beats inside you, it doesn't go away, it's always there, you know, you have flashbacks to memories of people and, you know, especially people, but also places and
yeah.
things, and just that it stays with you, and I just love that idea. It's a beautiful idea. So.
Right. So the two of you have a certain way of working together that kind of came back when you started working together again, or was it kind
yeah.
of like a new,
you know, it was familiar, but I think we worked more on this than we had on previous stuff.
Mm.
Eh? Yeah.
Mm.
So it was
we're very collaborative.
Yeah.
Very collaborative.
Yeah.
I don't write with anyone else the way I write with Paul.
Mm-hmm.
At all. We're very much lyrically and musically, everything, we bounce off each other. Do you like that? What could we do to that? What is this, you know? Yeah, we're just very kind of open with each other about stuff.
Right. Yeah. Well, I notice every song is a co-write.
What? What's
oh.
that?
fuck?
Jesus.
Yeah, he's like that a lot.
So yeah, so every song is a co-write.
Yeah.
So
that and sometimes it's more me, and often it's more Fiona.
Right.
With whatever, you come in with often choruses.
Yeah.
And ideas that are quite solid, and
we work it together.
And we build the structure around that to make it into a whole.
Gotcha. And there are other people that are collaborating with you
guys
as well.
Yeah. Matthias Jordan was a big part of the musical side of things.
Yeah.
Joost and Chris Vandergeer, Joost Langeveld and Chris Vandergeer, in terms of the production and just the kind of the overall getting it to the finish line over a long period of time, because that was
a few years.
Yeah. So, but Matthias has been really key in certain aspects, and just that amazing ability to, because Fiona can play keys
basically, though,
basic,
not like Matthias,
but he's a virtuoso, so he'll be like just go,
have you seen any of those come together shows that he's been on?
No.
Oh man, they're amazing.
Yeah. Because
first you're like, oh, it's just going to be like seeing a cover band, right?
Yeah.
But it's not.
No.
Yeah. And I've seen almost all of them now, and it's
right.
No, and I've seen him rehearsing. The amount of work that goes in behind the scenes when they're learning the, I don't know what, the 50 Beatles songs or whatever they have to learn before a show. It's just incredible.
It is amazing. Mm. You guys don't do a lot of live shows as Strawpeople.
We don't do any.
Yeah, no. I don't think so.
Not yet. But we are, we did one yesterday actually on RNZ.
Right.
Yeah, we did RNZ.
So that was, which is probably a bigger audience than we'd get from any
probably.
Physical live show.
Probably. Wow, that was our big gig.
Yeah. That was probably like a couple of Eden Parks full.
Right.
Yeah.
Yep.
But we are planning to we're planning to off the back of this
cool.
later in the year next year is kind of the what we're looking at, and we're just talking about it on the way in here actually about how we're going to approach it.
Very
stuff.
Exciting.
But
it would be pretty interesting. Yeah, I think you get a lot. I mean, because the whole '90s revival thing is a thing anyway, and both of you guys are part of that in your own special ways. Mm. So. Yeah, I think there's an audience there for it.
We're kind of on a bit of a high from the RNZ Live yesterday, actually.
Oh,
just in terms of how well it went and just the reaction we got from people. And
you seem surprised by that.
Oh, because it's a new thing.
Right.
Yeah.
All right.
But also, you never really know. Like occasionally people will say, you know, you come across people who will say, you know, your music meant a lot to me. And I took it with me to Europe when I left New Zealand, and there was nothing like that. And, you know... The songs mean something to people, but you don't know how. Is that 15 people or is that 15,000 people? It's hard to know.
Yeah, fair enough. Mm. Now we talked about the first song. I want to talk about the last song. Forget with Nick Atkinson. His sax is starting it up.
When did I forget to forget about you?
That was kind of a sketch rather than a song, but it's a cinematic kind of jazz poem, maybe. But Nick just brought it to life. When we got Nick into, I knew that I wanted sax on it, and when he came in, that kind of that's really
tied
built the song
up,
and
it?
Really made it. And cool. Just having him there with his bass clarinet and his tenor sax, and just absolute master, and just and cool. And a lovely man. So that
yes,
was,
he is. He's a good guy, isn't he?
Yeah. So part of the fun of making the album was actually, you know, going, hey, would you come in for a session? And oh, you will. Great. And then having the pleasure of being in the room with them making this thing.
Yeah.
It was, yeah, so, yeah, it was pretty cool.
Because that's a nice thing about Strawpeople, because I'm not the only vocalist. There's many, many vocalists.
Yep.
And so I think it's kind of like, I mean, essentially it's Paul and I.
Yep.
But the Strawpeople, who we would consider to be a part of the Strawpeople whānau, is quite wide.
Yep.
You know, there's a lot of people who are part of Strawpeople.
Yep.
Yeah, and we can't do it without them.
Okay. Very good. So that final song is kind of a dark ending to the album. How much thought and process did you have a concept of beginning to end?
Because we pressed it onto vinyl, we were thinking of it as a side one, side two thing. And I think it works quite well. It ends in this place, which is cinematic and drifts off into a, you know, it leaves you drifting off into this kind of a wet kind of courtyard somewhere, maybe, I don't know.
Yep.
So yeah, it was definitely intentional to end with that, and I think we spent quite a bit of time on deciding how the flow should go. Yeah.
Mm.
It's just tricky because there's two quite odd songs that instrumentals. The one that features Pope John Paul II and Idi Amin.
Yes.
And the one that features Luke Hurley, the guitarist. So they're quite different. They're like very early Strawpeople, kind of built around a concept and not a song as such.
Yep.
So they kind of had to go, but I think we found places for it, and
yep.
And I've experienced listening to it with friends and other people and stuff, and I think it feels like it flows pretty good.
So I wanted to talk to you about the Pope song. How is it pronounced? Love Diktat.
Diktat.
Love is the only basis for human relationship.
Everybody must love his leader. They must love their ministers. They must love their governors. They must love their district commissioners, their teachers, their chiefs. Everybody must be loved.
So what is your relationship with the Pope and Idi Amin?
Well, I grew up in the 70s, 80s.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm Catholic, lapsed. My parents were Irish, my dad's gone, but so yeah, there was always religious stuff around. They had a cassette recording of Pope John Paul in Ireland,
right?
Because he went to Ireland, which was a huge deal, and it was, you know, because Irish and Catholics, and a really interesting time because the IRA was still active at the time, and he spoke out against the IRA while he was there. I just finished a book by Fintan O'Toole, which is a brilliant history of Ireland, which I highly recommend. Anyway, so the Pope was always in my life. I had this cassette at home, and one day I played it. And I had this old cassette deck where I could record one thing on one channel and one thing on the other channel. And so I just played around, had Public Image playing on the other channel, so Johnny Rotten off that first Pill album or something, and I was putting the bits of the Pope in. And I just loved the idea of the of them being in the same band.
I'm sure Johnny would too.
Last couple of years I came across some Idi Amin stuff on YouTube, and I came across this thing of him making one of his pronouncements, because as he liked to do, and it was just him talking about love, and I thought, well, Idi Amin talking about love's interesting, and then I just put them together and imagined them in a duet in a karaoke lounge.
Cool.
Yeah. And that's that.
Oh, there's a new Public Image album just came out yesterday.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, it sounds pretty good.
Well, I haven't heard it yet.
Yeah.
Are they all still alive?
All the Pistols?
No, Public Image.
No, Keith Levine, just died.
Yeah, right.
So it's I don't know who the rest of the band is, but it's Johnny singing about
his... Was Jar Wobble in Public Image?
Yeah, for a while. Yep. But John's wife passed away recently. They'd been together for like 40 years or something, so it's kind of that kind of album, but it's pretty good. Check it out if you can. Now, a song that I can't believe, Baby It's You.
Yeah.
I have never heard that song before.
You've heard the original.
Nope.
Really?
Baby It's You.
Nope. So, and the interesting thing was, I found out, of course, that they're Canadian.
Yeah.
So I was living in Rochester, which is across...
I can't understand.
It was never released in the States.
No, really? It wasn't.
That's why.
It was never released in the States.
They had some kind of...
They cracked the rest of the world with that song.
So everybody's going, oh, you guys are covering Baby It's You. I was like, well, that's not the Smith song. That's not the Hal, Burt Bacharach.
Yeah.
I was like, what are they talking about?
No, they never did.
So I love it. I mean, obviously I know a thing about music.
Yeah.
But that was the one. And never, so.
Wow. This is fascinating.
Yeah.
Wow. I know it was huge in Australia. And it was number one in New Zealand, but now I know that now.
Have you seen the music video?
I just watched it.
Yes.
Yeah.
That was a very formative video.
Yeah, I can tell why.
As a child watching RTR Countdown.
Yep.
And I would have only, God, I wouldn't have been that old.
Well, we would have been about...
I was a teenager,
13,
though.
12, 13.
So it was like, oh, my God.
Oh, yep. My God. Yeah.
Yeah, I think I read in the comments somebody thought that the keyboard player who starts singing at the beginning and the girl who's the lead singer should change outfits.
Yeah, yeah.
So yeah, there's that. But yeah, did you just want to give your
It was always such a huge song when I was a child, and I've always loved it as the song that it is.
Right. Yeah.
But then I just wondered what it would be like to slow it down.
Yeah.
And make it really moody.
Baby, it's you who makes me feel the way that you do. No, I can't forget you so soon. Baby, it's you.
And so it took a little while for that song to come to fruition.
Yeah.
It took a while to get it right.
You worked at it.
Yeah, worked at it and got it. Because tried to add percussion to it, tried to add some drums to it. That didn't work. It just wanted to be stripped back.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
So when you're working on something like that and you want to get the right take and the right feel, how does that who's talking to who? Who's making those decisions? Are you two kind of the only ones in the studio at that point?
Well, that song was a lot me, actually, and it was me working with the engineer Jacob Rush.
Okay.
We actually worked on that song a lot together, right. And then afterwards another amazing guy, Luke Berryman, helped mix it and added his take. So yeah, that was different. But for other songs you did have input to that. We might listen and go, oh, like, no, turn that guitar up, make it crunchier, no, it's got to be a fuckload louder. Mm-hmm. You know, just and you just go,
sometimes
oh, yeah,
okay. It's very straightforward, and other times a song like Knucklebones is so far removed from our original, what we did originally. And then Chris comes in and goes, well, the drums aren't right. And we're like, okay, you're right, we'll listen to you.
Yeah.
And then, so that one sort of went through multiple iterations.
Mm.
Other ones, I mean, Second Heart really came together pretty seamlessly, and that was just us figuring out.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's different on different tracks.
Yeah.
I mean, I gotta say, it just sounded, when I first played the record, when it first came out, or got it, hearing your voice again was just like, oh, I feel better already.
Aww,
you know,
right.
I mean, there's something reassuring about a voice like that
yeah.
you've heard for 20 plus years, and there's something new, but it's so familiar.
And it's a powerful, voice.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And I've been hearing that a lot since the album's been out. So. Yeah.
And, you know, to be honest, it's kind of one of the reasons I wanted to do it is like, you know, we get this feedback, like Paul said, about there are life moments in my life where Strawpeople songs, you know, marked that time.
Mm-hmm.
And I just wanted to make some more music for people. I wanted to make more songs for fans, you know, including myself.
Yep.
I wanted to do that. We wanted to kind of...
She's doing it for the fans.
Well, kind of was, you know.
For the kids.
Just
the
like,
kids.
if we don't make this record, we don't make this record, and the songs don't exist.
Yep.
So...
Yep.
Wow. I hadn't thought of it like that. Why are we even here?
Well, we're gonna go down that rabbit hole.
Oh my God.
That's all mean.
Oh no. All right. So you've alluded to the fact that there may be some live shows in the future. Are you gonna, are there more songs? Is this an ongoing process now, or
absolutely.
Are you back to the?
We're back, baby. We'll go back into the. We'll deep dive into the back catalogue and you know, bring out all the big songs and also just songs we like. Like, you know, there's a couple of songs that I just want to sing.
Right.
And we'll get. You know, Lisa Corbin is definitely going to be part of the mix.
Yeah, so we'll drag back some of the people involved in the past.
Yeah.
Hopefully we haven't burnt too many bridges.
Well, I haven't. Paul.
She says.
So, yes.
Well, you can't. That's the thing I love about New Zealand is you can't burn the bridges. We're all stuck on the islands together.
Yeah.
And everybody has to get along no matter whether they do or not.
It's best not to, that's for sure.
Yeah.
So, we will, I mean, we've just finished this one, but we will start on new stuff, no doubt.
Yeah.
And but I think the live show will be, this new album and catalogue.
Yeah.
And okay. Surprises.
Yay. I like surprises.